Greetings. Thanks for your message, Brother Ali. So here are my questions to you. When was he crucified? Mark 15:25 says, "And it was the third hour, and they crucified him." John 19:14-16 says, "About the sixth hour, they cried out, 'Crucify him.' Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified." Let's read both passages in context. Mark 15:22, "And they bring him unto the place Golgotha, which is being interpreted, the place of the skull. And they gave him to drink wine mingled with myrrh, but he received it not." Other translations say vinegar. "And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them, what every man should take. And it was the third hour, and they crucified him." This is the verse you are taught to focus on. What time was he nailed to the cross? "And the superscription of his accusation was written over, 'The King of the Jews.' And with him they crucified two thieves, the one on his right hand, and the other on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, 'And he was numbered with the transgressors.'" John 19:12. "And from thenceforth Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, 'If you let this man go, you are not Caesar's friend. Whosoever makes himself a king speaks against Caesar.' When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth, and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover, and about the sixth hour, and he said unto the Jews, 'Behold your king.'" This is the second verse you are taught to focus on, because the hour number is different. "But they cried out, 'Away with him, away with him, crucify him.' Pilate said unto them, 'Shall I crucify your king?' The chief priests answered, 'We have no king but Caesar.' Then delivered he him therefore to them to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away." So sometime after the sixth hour, he has still not been nailed to the cross in this account. "And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of the skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two others with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. So there were two others also being crucified beside Jesus." Mark 15:27, "And with him they crucified two thieves, the one on his right hand, and the other on his left." And both accounts say Jesus was in the middle, where they crucified him and two others with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst, the one on his right hand, and the other on his left. So, honestly, comparing these accounts match perfectly. But Islam does not desire to be intellectually honest. Islam has only one goal, brother: attack the Word of God and replace it with Mohammed's Quran. Let's keep reading. "And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, 'Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews.'" Mark 15, "And the superscription of his accusation was written over, 'The King of the Jews.'" You should probably add this one to the list of inconsequential differences. One includes Jesus of Nazareth, while the other does not. The critical topic being relayed is the kingship, not who was crucified. This title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. Then said the chief priest of the Jews to Pilate, "Write not, or don't write, 'The King of the Jews,' but instead that he said, 'I am King of the Jews.'" This detail is not even mentioned in Mark's account, and that means exactly nothing. I understand, brother, you have been taught a strategy to attack the Word of God. You are taught that you must ignore the general message and vast majority of the text. Focus on irrelevant details as if they matter. And that fits Muhammad's mindset to rationalize the Quran. Surah 482. Do they not then meditate on the Quran? And if it were from any other than Allah, they would have found in it many a discrepancy or contradiction. With this surah and ayat, Muhammad introduces a very subtle logic error. Assume the Quran is true to begin with. Then create a false threshold to determine its authenticity from a deity. Then you are told there are no contradictions. There are, in fact, many, many numerical, factual, and logic errors, brother, if you look. They are easily found with Google or YouTube search. And rather than admit the errors disprove the Quran, followers of Islam make up excuses. My favorite is, you have to read the original Arabic, which makes no sense whatsoever. Numbers are numbers for numerical contradictions. The Bible, however, does not use this technique to establish authenticity, brother. In fact, the Bible does not borrow credentials from a previous book, hoping to replace the previous book. The Bible includes the entirety of the Torah in its whole original form. It does so because the credentials of Jesus come from the prophets, not from his or their ability to repeat a number 1,000 years apart. 2 Peter 1:19, and we have a prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. This is the real way God confirms his message, brother. God does not need to send another man to say, I confirm what so-and-so said. God confirms that he sent the prophet by making his message come true. Mark 15:28, and the scripture was fulfilled, which says, and he was numbered with the transgressors. That's originally from Isaiah 53:12. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong, because he poured out himself to death, and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. This is how God proves his word, brother. John 19:24. So they said one to another, let's not tear it, but instead let us cast lots to see who will get it. This was to fulfill the scripture, they divided my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. So that is what the soldiers did. Psalm 22:18. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. This is how God proves his word, brother. John 19:28. After this, Jesus, knowing that now all things had been accomplished, so that the scripture might be fulfilled, says, I thirst. A vessel of vinegar had been set there, so having put on a stalk of hyssop, a sponge filled with sour wine, they brought it to his mouth. Psalm 69:21. They put gall in my food and gave me vinegar for my thirst. This is how God proves his word, brother. Matthew 2:17. Then was fulfilled what was spoken through the prophet Jeremiah, saying, a voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing consolation because they are no more. Jeremiah 31:15. This is what the Lord says. A voice is heard in Ramah, mourning and great weeping, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. This is how God proves his word, brother. Not by the prophet saying, my message is from Allah unless you can find a mistake in it. You are free to hold on to the hour as proof the Bible is not from God. But the hour is not critical to the message, nor was it prophesied, that I have been able to find. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.